Welcome to our panel discussion on sustainable packaging in the FMCG industry. I'm Brandy Schuster, Head of Market and Customer Activation for Henkel Packaging Adhesives. With me today, I have Philippe Blanc, Head of Circular Economy and Packaging Sustainability for Henkel Beauty Care, and Dr. Thorsten Leopold, Director of Global Packaging Innovation for Henkel Home Care. Welcome, gentlemen. Thank you for joining us.
Hey, Brandy. Thanks for having us.
So within our Henkel Packaging Adhesive Sustainability Forum, our focus is primarily on the progress that we're making along the value chain with our partners. Of course, this is much less visible to consumers than what brand owners are doing. And Henkel can really be called a true B2B2C company with three business areas of adhesive technologies, which has industrial adhesives and consumer adhesives, beauty care, and laundry and home care. And we really do have some iconic brands that everyone would recognize, like Persil detergent or Schwarzkopf hair products. Today, we'd like to look at how we as a B2C company are driving the topic of sustainability in consumer packaging and what challenges brand owners are really facing today. Henkel, like many other global brand owners, has set really ambitious top packaging targets to achieve by 2025. Let's take a quick look at what those are. Okay, 150-0. Thorsten, tell us what these numbers mean.
Yeah, 150-0, right? So very easy to remember, very catchy. And this was also our intention. 150-0 describes the targets, how we at Henkel want to achieve our very ambitious targets in regard to circular economy. The 100 stands for that all our packs by 2025 latest should be designed to be recyclable or reusable. The 50 stands for our target to reduce the use of virgin plastic from fossil sources by 50% again in the year 2025. And the 0 stands for that we want to ensure that no plastic is leaking into the environment.
Okay, well, what does that really mean, though, in terms of concrete products and initiatives?
I mean, do you want to start?
Yeah, if we start with recyclability, for example, I mean, that is basically the foundation of bringing a circular economy to life. We need to design our packaging in a way that they can be easily recovered and recycled in existing infrastructure that is in practice and at scale. And that is really the starting point, and that is also one of our biggest responsibilities as a brand owner to design the packaging in the way that they can be recovered. And next to that, when it comes to reuse models, of course, looking at a waste pyramid, waste reduction comes first. The best packaging is the one we don't need. Of course, we have to basically take care of all the functions that a packaging actually brings into play, but of course material reduction is basically the best you can do, and reuse models are certainly playing into that bucket.
All right, and we talk about 50% less fossil
plastic,
right? What does that mean?
So, and here we also have different ways how to approach this target. So what can we do? We can integrate recycled plastic from PCR sources. And we are already doing this quite a lot in Europe and North America and PET and also in polyethylene bottles. So recycled plastic is definitely something that we want to push. And here we also set ourselves also an additional target that we want to integrate at least 30% recycled plastic until 2025. What can we do else? So what we can do more is we can, of course, replace plastic, reduce plastic, by lightweighting, but also replace plastic where it's not really needed. Good examples are, for example, soap bars or our power bars from laundry detergents, where actually a plastic is not needed, and we can pack the product in a paper packaging. This is one option that we are looking into. And then we're also looking into plastic that are not coming from fossil sources, but maybe from renewable sources, bioplastic.
Mm-hmm. All right, and then zero plastic waste. What does that mean?
Zero waste or zero plastic waste into nature actually means that we are taking care of what we are putting on the market. And how do we do that? Of course, it's pretty much linked to supporting existing waste management infrastructure. Like we have it in place already in the mature markets, not in everyone, but I mean, particularly looking at Europe, we have a kind of, let's say, working infrastructure when it comes to waste management. We have a extended producer responsibility that we are supporting, also supporting in areas where such a model is going to occur in the future. And but there is still a, let's say, remaining portion of unmanaged plastic waste that we are selling in regions where we don't have such an infrastructure. And here we are jointly collaborating with waste collection initiatives such as Plastic Bank, for example, to also take care of the remaining proportion of unmanaged plastic waste to basically recover the tonnage that we are putting on the market, the remaining one. And on top of that, it's also pretty much linked to consumer education, because by proactively educating the consumers on packaging when it comes to their disposal behaviors, we can also really make a difference and take them by the hand on that journey to also improve that we are not, or that we are reducing what is actually leaking in the environment.
So when we think about Henkel's approach to sustainability and with the sustainability with the packaging targets, how much of this is really driven by external factors, like the European plastic strategy or pressure from consumers and retailers? Does it come from that end, or is it more of a proactive strategy?
I think when it comes to Henkel, we can really build on a very strong history of when it comes to sustainability. So we do have embedded sustainability as one of our core values of the company since a very long time. We've been one of the first who were externally reporting about our environmental footprint by publishing a dedicated sustainability report already in 1991. So at times where basically sustainability was not the hot topic as it is today. And building on that, we have a responsibility as a brand owner, particularly in the fast-moving consumer goods industry. And we need to basically take care that we are leaving the least possible footprint with the operations we are actually doing. Mm-hmm. So I think there is a very strong, let's say, intrinsic motivation inside Henkel to work on that topic. But of course, we are also facing external pressure, being it peers, being it regulatory changes that are on the horizon when it comes to plastic, for example. We see a lot of activities coming from Brussels, for example, to really shape a circular economy. And here we are also contributing with our portfolios, and we want to be leading within our peers.
And it sounds like the brand owners really do have a really big responsibility when it comes to sustainability. What exactly does that mean for us?
When we talk about circular economy, I think one thing that we all need to understand is in a circular economy, every partner along the value chain has its role to play. Be it the material supplier, the converter, the brand owner, the collection or the recycling industry, right? Of course, we as a brand owner, we have a very important role to play because we are the ones that are designing and specifying the packaging, and therefore it's very, we can define, have the influence how to design it recyclable, reusable, and of course integrate more recycled or sustainable sources. And on the other hand, we are also communicating towards the consumer. So yes, brands have an important role, but each and every one can contribute.
Mm-hmm. Maybe to add on that, it's not, I mean, if we are looking at a circle, if there is only one player along the value chain that is not managing to basically provide his part, we will not manage to close the loop and make it circular. And therefore, we as brand owners are playing a super crucial role, because we have touch points along the value chain to more or less each and every stakeholder. And therefore, it's also our responsibility to influence them.
When we talk about this circle, when we talk about the value chain, consumers are also really a big part of that. What role do consumers play?
As Philippe said, also the consumer has a very important role to play, because if the consumer is not treating the waste at home correctly, of course, it cannot be collected correctly and it cannot be recycled. So that means, as I said, brand owners really need have also a role to play to educate the consumer, to do the right thing after use of the product, and how and that the right disposal is ensured.
And we talk about the rest of the value chain. What do you see as the main challenges along the value chain when it comes to sustainability and really specifically making sustainable packaging?
I think we need to look into the different regions, and because the different regions have different challenges. Looking to emerging markets, sometimes there is barely any collection infrastructure in place, and this is something that we as an industry need to tackle, because first comes collection and then recycling. So I think in these countries, this is something that needs to be solved as soon as possible. When I look to the more developed countries, there also already we have a collection and recycling infrastructure in place. But here, I would like to see more high quality recycling. That means high quality recycling where we can get material that we can feed back into our premium products that then again are accepted by our consumers. So high quality recycling I would name as a main challenge, especially here, for example, in Europe.
Yeah, maybe to add on that, from a multinational perspective, what we also see is that we are still looking at a very fractured landscape when it comes to regulation, and particularly recyclability is one pain point. Yeah? So how is recyclability assessed in different regions? And of course, this is linked to then infrastructure, but from a brand owner perspective, we would really like to see a harmonized approach because we are not... we will not develop single country solutions with our packagings, but we need to ensure that with what we are doing, that it works in the biggest possible, let's say, region, and that it's also widely accepted, and that everybody has the same understanding about recyclability, for example. So we need these high-level guidelines harmonized, and we are pretty much looking at a very, very fractured landscape, particularly in Europe, which makes our life not easier, let's say. That is certainly one of the main challenges as well.
All right, and Thorsten, you mentioned the quality of the recycled material that comes back into the stream as being a challenge. And looking at the target to have more than 30% recycled materials in our packaging by 2025, considering that the price of recycled materials is often higher than virgin plastic, how do we balance that out?
Exactly, this is a challenge, the price, because you're right, at the moment, high quality recycled plastic is significantly more expensive than virgin. And to really come to a sustainable circular economy, I think the complete industry now needs to work on to make recycled plastic and high quality recycling more competitive price-wise. I think this is really something we all need to work on.
And maybe to add on that, it's really a systemic industry shift that we are looking at the moment when it comes to plastic raw materials. So the classical virgin plastic that we know from the past, it might not even be there, at least not at that, let's say, quantities in 10 years from now. So the industry is catching up, but there's also a huge demand. That's why prices today are quite high. But it's what we are currently looking at is really a typical chicken and egg situation when it comes to availability of high quality material. And so that will, let's say, hopefully become, let's say, less stressful in the years to come when the industry is ramping up capacities. And today it's really a war on material when it comes to high quality recycled resins. But we see also, let's say, complementary streams when it comes to advanced recycling, for example, that we will need on the long run to really make our packaging fully circular, because it's also true that plastic is not infinitely recyclable. So they are losing their properties from cycle to cycle. So you need to fuel fresh material in at a certain point in time. And here, that is the point in time where advanced recycled solutions will come into play. Being a complementary material class to the classical mechanical recycled materials that we know today.
So in this case, you would mean like chemical recycling? Correct?
For example, yeah.
Okay. I mean, when we talk about this, it sounds like the role of the brand owner really isn't just to create sustainable packaging and then that's it. It goes to supporting infrastructure in different regions and that sort of, in the proper cycles and that sort of thing. What about the social aspect of it? I know that we're involved with Plastic Bank. What role does that play for us as a company and for our sustainability packaging strategy?
Mm. Our collaboration with Plastic Bank is really a very special one. So Henkel has been the first global FMCG who basically teamed up with them. The concept is actually to create infrastructure and ecosystems for plastic waste collection in regions and countries where nothing exists. And we have been collaborating since 2017. This is where our partnership started. And we started in Haiti, funded dedicated collection centers there to basically provide an ecosystem for the local population. And at the same time, while they are bringing back the material that they are collecting from the environment and that otherwise would have ended up in the ocean, let's say, so it's so-called ocean-bound plastic, they are bringing it back to the collection centers and they receive an incentive for that. And it could be money, but there is a huge, let's say, range of incentives that they can basically get there. It spans from medication towards tuition fees for their children, actually. Mm-hmm. So sustainable cooking fuel, Wi-Fi minutes, stuff like this. And that is really creating local communities around this plastic collection topic, and at the same time is empowering them to basically step out of poverty, because by brand owners paying a premium for such material, it really makes a difference and it really stimulates collecting on the ground. And this is how it started in 2017. And meanwhile, we have expanded our partnership. We have prolonged our partnership end of last year for another 5 years. We decided to also develop new regions. Plastic Bank is anyways expanding, not only Haiti, but having a huge footprint meanwhile also in Southeast Asia. And what we have agreed on is that we would like to develop Egypt as a country from scratch, where also classical waste management infrastructure is really lacking. And here we intend to build up a collection ecosystem infrastructure with more than 400 collection points. And we intend to collect more than 5,000 tons of material per year once this is up and running, which over the runtime will basically prevent more than 1 billion bottles ending up in the environment. Mm-hmm. So that is the whole concept. And there are many ways to engage with Plastic Bank when it comes to impact programs and funding infrastructure. But the Champions League is really to take this dedicated material and bring it back into your own packaging, actually. And this is what we are doing. What we have also pioneered with them, so creating the supply chain behind that. And that's a great success story. Has been awarded several times meanwhile gained some great external recognition as well. And overall, this is really our corporate social responsibility lighthouse in the field of packaging.
Maybe to add on this, I think this cooperation with Plastic Bank is really a win-win situation for everyone, because we are reducing the amount of plastic that is entering the ocean. We're giving people in need a regular income. And on the other side, we're integrating the plastic that we are collecting back into our products. And Henkel this year integrated social plastic in more than 15 million bottles. So I think this is a great, great, very motivating initiative that we have.
All right, so the three of us are here representing the three business units of Henkel, Adhesive Technologies, Henkel Laundry and Home Care, and Henkel Beauty Care. How do our business units work together when it comes to sustainable packaging?
So we have a close cooperation and exchange on new innovation, for example. And I think that we have everyone under one roof, I think, is really a USP of Henkel. And I would like to give you two examples, right? So the first example is, together with our adhesive colleague, we designed and innovated on a recyclable pouch for a laundry detergent. We optimized the adhesive to make the pouch fully recyclable, and we integrated also PCR. So this we did together also with Borealis, and it was a very good success, and we are now implementing this in our portfolio. And the second example is, we at Henkel, we developed jointly and tool, it's called EasyD4R, and it is a tool to assess the recyclability of packaging, not only of plastic, but also paper, metal, and so on. And of course, here, when we designing and defining what is recyclable, of course, the exchange with our experts from adhesives really help, because often adhesives play also an important role when it comes to recyclability of packaging. So yes, it's a very fruitful collaboration among the three business units.
Philippe, how about for beauty care?
Yeah, maybe to add on that. I mean, our internal collaboration is really going beyond primary packaging. Yeah? So what we are doing as well is bringing the teams together to jointly work on secondary optimization. And one good example we are having here is the palletization topic, where today usually you have wrap foil to secure the pallet and ensure transportation and logistical safety. And here Adhesive Technologies have developed a very innovative adhesive solution to glue the boxes instead of securing it with a wrapped foil. So it's really about reducing the plastic consumption and the material consumption here. And this is where we are also jointly working on.
Mm-hmm. All right. The million-dollar question for both of you now to wrap this up. How would you sum up the future of consumer packaging in one sentence? Thorsten.
Yeah, to frame it in one sentence, of course, hard. It's complex. But I would say the future of packaging is in reduce, reuse, and recycle. And not only for plastic packaging, but also for metal, glass, paper packaging.
Philippe.
I think we have to rethink the way we are packing classical consumer goods products today. And we need to disrupt consumer behavior, distribution models, as well as material consumption as such, moving away from this classical linear take, make, dispose attitude that we are having today, and really moving into a more circular and regenerative system.
All right, thank you. I think that, I mean, this discussion has also shown us that nobody can do it by themselves in the value chain. And the brand owners really do play a very important role. And it's not just about making sustainable packaging. It's really about supporting the infrastructure. It's about supporting the stream of recycled material that comes in. So thank you both very much for joining us today.
Thank you.
Philippe will be available for questions and answers now after this session, and he will also be available in the speaker area to discuss with you. Thank you very much for tuning in.